I think every astronaut who goes into space does learn the value of Earth and has a different perspective of Earth. It's impossible not to be, you know, changed by looking back on your home planet and having a fresh appreciation of how tiny Earth is and how vulnerable it looks and how fragile it looks in this vast universe.
What do you think the attraction is of going into space?
I think there's on several levels. I mean, it's attractive because it's the future. It's the future of exploration, the unknown, pushing boundaries. Also, the future of science and technology and engineering. Really, the stuff we're doing in space is at the cutting edge of what humans are capable of doing and what technology is capable of doing. So it's fascinating to many people on different levels.
You talk about the importance of international partnership. I think no one would gainsay that. Is that something that is becoming more difficult because we're in generally troubled times of international cooperation? Is that going to affect the new race for space?
I don't think so. If you look over the history of the space program since Apollo-Soyuz first started working together in the 70s, there's been an awful lot of political tension between different factions there throughout that era. What we're doing in space, and to many degrees, what we do in science globally, it has an ability to transcend political differences. So we have to work together as partnership now. We have to pool our resources, pool our funding together, and our technology and our expertise and our ingenuity. But that actually in itself has created this really strong partnership, which is fantastic, and will continue on to our next project, which is to go back to the moon. So we're doing it in a more combined partnership. We're doing it in a more sustainable fashion, not just to go back to the moon and return home, but to go there and stay, and as a stepping stone onto Mars. So it's a very exciting future, but it does need political stability. It does need financial stability. Any long duration space program has to have those two things to work. And the one good thing that we have got to build on is this international collaboration.
Obviously, first step, the moon, but we've been to the moon. Why do we want to go back?
Yeah, so there's a couple of good reasons for going back to the moon. Firstly, is we've barely scratched the surface. We've got so much to learn about the moon. The moon was probably formed from an early collision with the Earth, so it's part of us. And yet, having been out there untouched for 4.5 billion years, it acts as a repository of information about the solar system's formation. And that can really teach us a lot. And in addition, in terms of exploration, it's a natural place to start learning about how to live and work properly on another celestial body, you know, with a permanent presence and understanding that environment as a stepping stone onto Mars and potentially some of the moons of perhaps Jupiter and Saturn.
To go back to the moon, do we have the technology to go back and stay? Do we have the technology now, or are there missing bits that we still have to develop?
Well, there are bits that we have to develop, but we have the technology, as in there is nothing outside of what is not possible with today's manufacturing techniques and our capabilities. So we have already manufactured the spacecraft that's going to take us there, the Orion. We've already manufactured the service module, the European service module for that spacecraft. So that technology exists. It's been manufactured. It's going to fly within the next couple of years. The Gateway is a smaller version of the International Space Station. There's nothing that we cannot do there that we haven't done before. And so the one element that we need to still develop more is the lander system. But again, we've landed on the moon. We know how to do that. So there are no hurdles that are yet to overcome in order to getting to the surface of the moon. In terms of staying there, we need to put up habitation modules, but there are some really ingenious ways we can do that. We can use inflatable modules, we can use 3D printing techniques from Lunar Regolith. All these kind of technologies are being explored. In the early stages, I expect we'll use modules very similar to what we've seen on space stations, because that's easy for us to do. But I expect things like the 3D printed habitation modules, that's a thing that's certainly within our grasp in the future. Or even using underground areas on the surface of the moon, which give us radiation protection as well.
And how do we make those communities sustainable, as in self-sustaining?
the way that we're going to make these sustainable is by improving the technologies that we've already developed on the space station, for example, of how to recycle our water, how to recycle our air, how to make our solar panels more efficient. There are places on the lunar surface which are in 80% sunlight, so it's a naturally good place to start with a habitation module there. And so we're going to develop these techniques as we occupy the moon and we learn more about our environment.
And of course, we will necessarily be exploiting resources on the moon. You mentioned in your talk the water ice near the South Pole of the moon, where we can extract water and oxygen, not just to sustain ourselves, but for rocket fuel. Is there a danger that we start to overexploit those resources?
We will certainly have to manage our exploration of the moon very carefully and in a coordinated manner. I think some of the most important things we need right now, more than the technology that we spoke about, is the political framework, such as the United Nations, in giving us a more up-to-date outer space treaty that deals with the protection of these environments. We know that nobody owns the moon, but it's a little bit vague and it can be read in different ways by different corporations, different nations, commercial entities, for example. So I think we need stronger and clearer regulatory framework for the use of outer space and for this exploration. I think that's very important in order to protect the lunar environment, to protect Mars, and to protect other bodies in the solar system. But we do have time. We're not suddenly going to see thousands of people going off to the moon within the next couple of decades. This is going to take a long period of time, and the initial stages will be very limited exploration of the moon.
Because as you mentioned there, it's not just nations, it's potentially commercial operations. Does that bring new challenges that we need to think about in terms of regulation in space?
Yeah, the commercial partnership with commercial entities, it brings new challenges, but it also brings incredible new opportunities. And actually, I mean, who hasn't been encouraged by seeing some of the sustainability that SpaceX, for example, have managed to achieve with reusing first stage, second stage boosters, bringing down the cost of access to space and making it a more sustainable project. We already work hand in hand with commercial entities for resupply of the space station. Next year, we'll see two commercial vehicles, Boeing and SpaceX, providing crew to the space station. And we're already working in partnership with commercial entities to help build this gateway in orbit around the moon and to go back to the surface of the moon. Companies like Blue Origin as well, which are very developed in their lunar landing systems, will be key in working with commercial entities. So yes, challenges, but also I think far more than that, greater potential and opportunity.
Because it's not just about sustainability, I guess. There's already a problem with space debris, which is only going to get worse, you would have thought, with lots of people competing to put up satellites in orbit. To what extent is that a problem now?
Space debris is a problem now. I think it's only going to get better, actually, in terms of we understand the problem. And everybody realizes how valuable space is, which means that everybody wants to protect that environment. If you're a commercial entity, the last thing you want is your expensive satellite being destroyed. And clearly, if you have humans in space, the last thing you want is a risk of a collision as well. Everybody is working towards minimizing space debris and identifying techniques for cleaning up space. And any satellite that goes into orbit, in making sure that we can deorbit it safely, either to burn up in the atmosphere or to go far away from planet Earth. So I think the fact that we now have a greater understanding of how big the space debris problem is means that everyone is working to reduce that problem.
Another interesting aspect of the new space age that you mentioned in your talk was the psychological aspect. If we're going to the moon and spending a long time there, or even using that as a stepping stone to Mars, it takes 8 or 9 months to get to Mars. How do we ensure the psychological robustness and the cooperation of team members?
Yes, so we are going to have to be incredibly careful when we select astronauts for those future missions. And that's something we have been working on for many years in terms of the psychological profiling, for example, that we've used to select astronauts to date. So yes, we're going to have to work very carefully on that. And once we've selected those astronauts, we need to work equally carefully on the training that they receive to prepare them as well as we can for what they're about to do. But I certainly believe it's within human tolerance, both physiologically and psychologically, to be able to go on a long duration 3-year mission to Mars. We've already had a simulation of that, for example, in the Mars 500 study, which was done outside of Moscow. And you know, we're learning an awful lot about the kind of psychological profile that's going to be required for those missions.
And what about, I know this is going way into the future, but imagine we establish a colony on Mars. What about governance there? You know, if something goes wrong and it takes 8-9 months for someone to come out from Earth, how do we ensure that there are robust structures, societal structures?
I think that's where it comes down to, again, the conversations we need to have right now, important conversations about how we legislate and regulate the space environment and, for example, colonies on Mars, colonies on the Moon. So we need to, certainly before those missions occur, that needs to be in place.
Have we thought enough about the psychology, even of the remoteness from Earth? I mean, you talked about always, when you're on International Space Station, always having the Earth there and indeed admiring the Earth. But when Earth is a barely visible blue dot, how does that change the psychology of being in space, do you think?
I think it's going to be something that our future astronauts on these missions to Mars, it is going to be incredible to actually witness the Earth disappearing to just a small speck of light in the sky. It was, I've had the pleasure of talking to several Apollo astronauts about that experience of seeing the Earth disappear to so small it could just be covered up by a thumb out of the window. So I think we need to look at lessons from the past, from our Apollo colleagues and from studies that we've been doing in order to apply them to the future of space exploration and really understand that environment that future astronauts are going to need to work in.
Would you yourself want to go to the Moon or even Mars?
I would love a mission to the Moon. I think I find that absolutely fascinating. It's within my career time frame, so there is a possibility of getting that mission. I think it would be extremely challenging, very rewarding as well. I think a mission to Mars, at the moment I've got two young sons, and I think a 3-year mission away for any father is a long period of time. And so I think that you have a responsibility as a father to be there for your children whilst they're growing up. Once they're at university and off doing their own thing, then who knows?
What sort of time frame do you think we're talking about of going to Mars? What's realistic?
I think in the next 10 years, we are going to see a settlement on the surface of the Moon. We're going to see regular tours and rotations of astronauts going to live and work on the Moon. I think the decade after that is when we'll start to see Mars exploration in terms of, firstly, humans going in orbit around Mars and then landing on the surface. So I do think we're talking about the late 2030s into the 2040s for those first surface landing missions on Mars. 50, 100 years in the future, I think we'll have several outposts on the lunar surface. I think we'll see regular missions going to the Moon, both commercial and national space agencies. And I think we'll also have outposts on Mars within a 50 to 100 years time. Absolutely. And I think we'll also see that we've cut down our propulsion techniques as well. It won't be an 8-month journey in 50 to 100 years time. You know, we'll probably have that down to about 2 months.
Will we be coming back to Earth or will we be staying away?
Yes, you can look thousands of years into the future where there may be civilizations, human civilizations that don't come back to Earth. But for right now, it's talking about exploration with a view to returning to Earth.
Is that a reason to go to space to teach us the value of Earth?
I think every astronaut who goes into space does learn the value of Earth and has a different perspective of Earth. It's impossible not to be changed by looking back on your home planet and having a fresh appreciation of how tiny Earth is and how vulnerable it looks and how fragile it looks in this vast universe. So I think it does certainly teach us about our place in the universe.